Note frequency control, in which we will study the role of system frequency in real power control, concept of load frequency, area concept, in which we will study the single area and multi-area load frequency control scheme, steady state and dynamic response. Steady state means when the time is constant, dynamic response means when the time is varying. Automatic load frequency control for interconnected power system and automatic load dispatching. So before we start, I will discuss some important term. So role of system frequency in real power control. So when we do the load flow, when we do the load flow analysis, the two important terms came, that is the magnitude of voltage and angle. So when we'll talk about the active power, so when there is a at bus, suppose in load flow there are lots of bus are interconnected, so at bus is when the power active power is changed, then in that case it will affect the angle, and when the reactive power is changed at buses, then the voltage magnitude is changed. So how it will be controlled? It will be controlled by the frequency and voltage. So it is also called the load frequency control, and this one is called the excitation voltage control. In some case, it is also called angle control. And it is called QV control. So, everybody know what is the frequency? Let me tell you, the frequency is the rate at which something occurs or it repeated over a particular period of time. What it means? It means, suppose here is a two waveform, it is shown here. The one waveform having a time period of T1, the second is also having the same time period. The first one having a frequency of F1 and the second one is having a frequency of F2. So let me ask one question, which one is having a higher frequency? The answer will be the frequency 2 will be the higher than the frequency 1, because in same time period, it crosses two times the same, means it repeated two times, means the frequency is high here. So this is a high frequency waveform and this one is a low frequency waveform. And the second question is, what is the need of constant frequency? So the answer is, at our home, all of the equipment are either mostly the induction motor and it is operated at a constant frequency. So we have to maintain the constant frequency to operate this equipment at a rated frequency. If suppose the frequency will deviate, it will increase or decrease. So in that case, that equipment will damage or it will not perform. It will not perform correctly or losses will occur. So all this case we have to reduce, we have to maintain the frequency. In terms of frequency, we have to maintain constant frequency. Now we will see what is the importance of frequency in the further slides. Okay. I have written here, sir. So let me first read this slide and we have to understand what is meaning by these all 4 points. In a power system, both active power and reactive power, active power demand, D for here demand, it is demand. So active power demand and reactive power demand are never steady. It means it is either increasing or it is decreasing. Similarly, in case of reactive power, it is increasing or decreasing and they continuously change with the rising and falling trend. It means here I have drawn the load curve. So the load curve is basically is given by this diagram and we have studied in the unit 2, that is the demand factor, diversity factor, the maximum demand, what are the reserve capacity and capacity factor, all of these have covered in the unit 2. So This is the meaning of point one. The second one is the active power demand. How it will be managed? So we cannot. The demand is varying continuously. The active power demand as well as the reactive power demand is changing continuously. So we cannot force the consumer to increase the demand or decrease the demand. So what we have option? We have to match this demand according to our generation. So we have to match this generation, means we have to match up this demand, how much is demand increasing or how much is demand at a particular time, we have to generate that much of demand. Either it is an active power or it is a reactive power. So we will see. So how it will be managed? So there is a two terms came. One is the frequency and second is the voltage. The permissible limit of frequency is 2% and voltage is 5%. So it is seen that if we have maintained the frequency within the 2%, then we are able to manage the generation equal to the demand, means the balance, the power balance. There is a balancing power of active power as well as the reactive power. In reactive power, what we will do? We will manage the voltage up to the 5%. So how it will be managed, how we will cover the frequency we will put into within the 2% and voltage within the 5%, we will see in unit 4. The voltage concept, the excitation voltage control concept, we will see in unit 4. And the frequency concept, that is a load frequency control concept, we will see in unit 3. So, the active power demand is related to what? It is related to frequency. Similarly, the reactive power demand is related to voltage. So, steam input to the turbo generator or water input to the hydro generator must therefore be continuously regulated to match the active power demand. It should be continuously regulated, means it continuously should be increased or decreased. Steam input in case of the thermal power plant and the water input in case of the hydropower plant. Failing which, the machine speed will vary with consequent change in the frequency and it may be highly undesirable. So, we don't want to vary the frequency that much beyond the limit of 2%. Similarly, in case of the reactive power demand, the excitation of the generator must be continuously regulated to match the reactive power demand with reactive power generation. Match the reactive power demand with reactive power generation. Otherwise, the voltage at various system may go beyond the prescribed limit. So, we don't want to increase the voltage within the 5% plus minus 5% of range. Similarly, in case of frequency plus minus 2%, it is the permissible limit. We will see how it will be vary. So, in the next slide, we will see here. So, automatic generation control. As I told you, the demand is constant, which is seen here. The demand is constant, that is active power demand and reactive power demand. So, we cannot told the customer that you have to increase or decrease the demand. So, we have to match up the active power generation as well as the reactive power generation. So, how it will be done? It will be done when we have to maintain the frequency within the plus minus 2% and we have to maintain the voltage plus minus 5%. So, how it will be interrelated when the demand is increases. Here I have seen that the demand is increasing, so frequency will decrease. So, frequency will decrease means we have to increase the generation to match up the demand so that the frequency will increase and the error gets zero. So, what we will do? We will increase the steam input in case of the thermal power plant and we will increase the water in case of the hydropower plant. Similarly, in case of the reactive power demand, when the demand is increases, there is a drop in the voltage. So, we to reduce the error of voltage to within the prescribed limit, we have to increase the reactive power generation. So, how it will be done? It will be done by increasing the excitation. So, when the excitation will increase, so it will increase the reactive power generation and it will be matched the increase reactive power demand. So, I can say the automatic generation control is having a combination of load frequency control as well as the excitation voltage control. So, in the unit 3rd, we will see the load frequency control and excitation control we will see in unit 4. In case of load frequency control, here is the diagram. You can see here there are two loops involved. The first one is the load frequency control loop. The second one is the excitation control loop. So here we can see the turbine is coupled with the generator with the help of shaft. So suppose let the generation, the power, change in power generation in delta Pg and change in reactive power generation in delta Qg, and demand is, active power demand is Pd and reactive power demand is Qd. So suppose the active power demand is increases, now the frequency will decrease. So frequency will decrease and we have to maintain the frequency up to the 50 Hz in case of India and 60 Hz in case of USA. So what will be the error? So error will be negative, because the Fe is equal to Fz minus F reference. So F reference is equal to 50 Hz and the frequency Fz reduces to 49.5. Let's suppose 49.5. So the error is minus of 0.5. So it is a negative error. So when the negative error will come, so there is a valve control mechanism. It is based upon the fly valve mechanism. So when there is a negative error, the valve will open. In that case, the valve will open and the more input will flow to the valve and it will feed to the turbine. So the turbine will rotate more and the wind turbine will rotate more. It is coupled with the generator, so it will also rotate more and the generation, active power generation will be more. So Pg will be more and it will be match up to the increase active power demand. So like that, this loop is controlled. So here what we have done, we are controlling the frequency. So that is why it is called the load frequency control, because it depends upon the change in variation of the loads. So when the load is changing, according to that the frequency is changing, and according to that the valve will open, means governor system is operating and the valve is opening or closing, and then the turbine input is given, the flow rate of the steam is increases according to the increase or decrease of the demand, and it is coupled with the generator, so the generator output will increase or decrease. But there is one important note is written here, that the we cannot increase the flow rate beyond the permissible limit of the turbine and generator, because its turbine and generator has its own limit. So we cannot only increase the flow rate and we will get the desired generation if the demand is very high. In that case, the load curtailment concept came. We will cut down the load if the demand is very high. We cannot able to match up the generation. So in that case, we have to cut the load. So that is why it is written here. The second loop is having here, the when there is a increase of the reactive power demand. So in that case, the voltage will drop and we will increase. We have to maintain this voltage error to zero. So the voltage sensor will sense the value. The voltage error will be the Vz, whatever the generating, minus V reference. So we have to maintain one per unit, and according to that, that voltage will reduce. And automotive voltage regulator, according to that error less than or greater than zero, it will increase or decrease the excitation of the generator. So here is the excitation system. So here the electronic circuit involved. And here all the mechanical part is involved. So that is why the mechanical time, as we all know, the mechanical time constant is higher than the electrical time constant. So which system will be faster? Either load frequency control system or excitation voltage control system. So it is obviously the excitation voltage control system will be faster, because it is having a time constant of 0.01 or 0.001 second. And in case of the mechanical time constant, it is slower. So the response of that load frequency control is slower, because it is having a time constant of 1 second or 2 second like that. So that is a very important point. It may be asking the objective question. So whatever we have discussed here, I have summarized in some points. The error is given is equal to Fz minus f reference. So f reference is nothing but 50 hertz. Fz is increasing or decreasing. Let's suppose the frequency is increases. It is reaches to 50.2 hertz. So in that case, the error is plus 0.2. So if error is plus 0.2, so in that case we have to close the valve. How it will? Because the frequency increases means there is a decrease in the demand. Because the thumb rule, what we have a thumb rule? The thumb rule is when the demand is increases, the frequency decreases. Similarly, when the demand decreases, the frequency increases. So we have to increase the generation here, active power generation, and we have to decrease the active power generation. So how the reactive power generation will decrease? We will feed the turbine with less steam flow. Or here we have to increase, we have to increase steam flow. So if the in flow of rate of steam will be high, the generation will be high and we will match up the increased demand. If the flow will be less, then the demand, we will reduce the generation. In that case, we will match up the reduced demand. So overall, the error is getting the zero. If the, we will get the error zero, means we will having a frequency equal to the reference frequency, then no mechanism required for the valve opening. And the second case, when the frequency is less, then the error will be negative. In that case, we have less means what? We will reduce frequency. In that case, we have to increase the generation. Then we have to increase the valve input. We have to increase the steam flow. And in that case, the valve open until Fg is equal to F reference. In the third case, when the demand decreases, the frequency increases, so we have to reduce the generation. So we have to less steam flow. So in the, how it will be done? It will be when we close the valve and up to where? When the error is equal to zero. So there are lots of questions may be asked. When the error will be zero, either it is increasing or decreasing, in that case, when the valve will open and when valve will close, when the power demand increases, what happened to the valve and what happened to the frequency error, like that, the lots of questions may be asked in the objective. This important concept is clear to all of you, I hope. Now the next topic is control area concept. So in this we will cover the single area as well as the multi-area load frequency control scheme. And the next topic in this we will cover steady state as well as the dynamic response. In steady state means nothing but when the time is constant, and dynamic means the time is varying. So we will see what is the steady state and dynamic response of the frequency. So let's first understand what is the meaning of control area 1 and control area 2. So the any power stations, there are lots of power generating station are there. So these are the substation, and substation means sub part of the station, means here also the generating station, here also generating station, like that. There are n number of generating station. So one generating station is come into the one area, means we have all the control strategy in this area, control strategy in this area. Similarly, in case of the second, the again this mechanism for controlling the steam flow and whatever the plant we are using. So these all are interconnected. How they are interconnected? They are interconnected with the tie lines. So they all are interconnected, and in the unit 2 we have studied the economic load dispatch. So what we have studied in that, the generation is rescheduled, G1, G2, G3, like that. They have to reschedule their generation to match up the demand. So whatever the demand is there, so one thumb rule is there, the power generation is the demand plus losses. We have also considered in the unit numerical, the losses is also there. So we have also seen there the losses concept is also there. Okay, so the here I have taken the example of only two area control system. So control area 1 and control area 2. In the control area 1, all the generator, turbine and all the control strategy is involved here. Similarly, in that case, turbine, generator and frequency sensor, all the concept is involved. We have studied in the previous slides. So these are all interconnected with the tie line, and the power flow is called tie line power flow. Tie line power flow. So we will see as to the how they are means understand. So they are understand with the help of mathematical formula. So we will see the transfer function of all these governor ball, turbines and power system, and they are how they are interconnected and what are the feedback involved. So all these are a study with the help of the mathematical block diagram. So now in the next slide we will study the mathematical diagram in case of a single area and in case of a multi area. Like in unit 2 we have only two area concept. So let's start with the single area block diagram, in which we will see how the what are the transfer function of the turbine and what are the governor system and power system and how they are interconnected with the regulation. Okay, so let's start. Load frequency control of single area system. To analyze the load frequency control of an isolated system, we need two mathematical model from the block diagram. So there are two incremental input. First we should know, one is the change in the speed changer position, which is given by the delta PC, and the second one is the change in the load demand, delta PD or delta PL. So there are two types of response. The one is the steady state or static response, in which the time constant T will be constant, and the second one is the dynamic state response, in which the time is variable. So these static response is analysis with the help of three cases. The first case is a constant in speed changer position with variable load demand, which means it is in which the speed changer position will be a constant and the load will be varying. So it is called the uncontrolled case. The second case, the constant load demand with variable speed changer position, which is also called the control case, in which the constant load demand means the demand is constant and the speed changer position is changing. And the third one is the variable load demand and speed changer position, in which means a delta PL plus a delta PC both will variable, means both will change. So let's start with the single area load frequency control. So before that, the responses in which the responses has a response of turbo generator depends on the three kind of thing. One is the speed governor mechanism, the second one is the turbine response, and the third one is the power system response. And the speed governor system is also depend on three things. The one is the speed changer, the second one is the fly ball mechanism, and the third one is the relay valve and servo motor. So we will see in the block diagram what this does mean. So let's start the static analysis load frequency control of uncontrolled case. So uncontrolled case, what I have told, so in an uncontrolled case in which we will take the delta PC is equal to zero, means the speed changer position will be a constant, or it is also called the free governor operation. The second case was in that the delta PL will be varying. So in case of the uncontrolled case, the delta PL will be constant. Delta PL will be varying, and delta PC will be constant or it is zero. It is called the uncontrolled case, as I told you here. So first uncontrolled case means constant speed changer position. Constant speed changer position means delta PC will be zero, and variable load demand means delta PL will be varying. Load means varying. Okay. So here is a block diagram of that system, in which the first one is the governor block, So the transfer function of this governor block is given by the kz, g for governor, kz upon 1 plus s into tz. Tz is the time constant. The second is the turbine response. It is given by the kt upon 1 plus s into tt. And the third one is the power system response, and which is given by the kp, kp for p for power system upon 1 plus s into tp. So it is given by the feedback of 1 upon r. And the feedback is negative feedback, and as I told, we are studying the uncontrolled case, so delta PC will be a zero. And one important point is here, the load delta PL is also a negative feedback, and here is a delta change in the power generation. So both R is a negatively added. So this point should be notice while writing the block diagram. So bearing by using the block diagram reduction technique, let's start what I have done. So I have to reduce all the blocks. So first of all, the delta PL is zero. So and by multiplying this another two blocks, so what we will get? We will get the gain constant G and T for governor plus turbine. So it is when combining the upper two blocks, we will get the KZ and KT and divided by 1 plus S TZ. Multiply by 1 plus s dt, and thus all the blocks are still same. Delta f is the frequency, change in frequency, static frequency, because we are studying the static response. Again, using the block diagram, what we will do, we will multiply these two blocks, we will multiply these two blocks, and we will reduce the next block. So here we can say, after multiplying, what we have get the overall block diagram reduction. The GP is the gain constant of power response. So KP upon 1 plus S into TP. And here is the same change in frequency. And by multiplying these two blocks, 1 by R into 1 by R into the this term, 1 by R into this term. So while if you will write on the paper, you will understand very easily. Again, I have to reduce. So before that, I have just put this value, means I have put this block value to the GP, only GPS, and only the whole block is given by the G of GTS, so that the calculation will be easy. So after writing this, so what is the transfer function? The transfer function is given by GS upon 1 plus GS into HS when the HS is given to the negative feedback. So here, what is the value of HS? It is a 1 upon R of G of GT of S. And what is the gain? It is a GP of S. So by multiplying output upon input, so output is delta FS. So delta FS upon input is what is minus? It is a minus delta PS. It is a GS upon 1 plus GS into HS. So what is G? Our G is here GPS. And what is the H? H is our open or GT into S, which is given here. Okay. Now look here. So if I will transfer this to here, means cross multiplication, cross multi means I have multiplied delta P out of both sides. So delta FS is given by the GPS, and this minus 1 is of this minus 1. So minus 1 divided by 1 plus R GT of S into GPS, and multiply by delta PL into S. So for sudden step change in low demand, so delta PS, this delta PS is given by delta PL upon S. S is for the step input for sudden change. So again explain, while I have now written the GP value to the original form. So delta FS is given by minus KP upon 1 plus S into, this is the for power system response, and other term, this is a power system, and it is a combination of governor and turbine. And here the delta PS upon S for the in case of sudden step change in the load demand. Now, using the final value theorem, so where the final value theorem is used, the final value theorem used for the steady state analysis. So what the final value theorem says, it is says that it is written here at the limit of s tends to 0, s of fs. So by putting the s and putting the value of fs, we will get the frequency, steady state analysis of frequency, change in frequency. So limit of s tends to 0 s, so this s is cancelled out by this s, and the s, we will put the s value is equal to 0. So this term is will get 0, this term will get 0, and this both term will get 0. So only what we have left, we have left this kp value, and here we will get minus kp value. So final, what we get the final value, we'll see here. The final value after calculation, we will get the delta F static is equal to minus of Kp upon 1 plus Kp upon R into delta PL. So delta PL is what? Delta PL is a change in demand or change in load. So after, so the what will be the final formula? So this formula is used for the numerical purpose. So delta F static is equal to minus of Kp upon 1 plus Kp upon R into delta PL. So one important notice is here, the Kz and Kt is the multiplication of Kz, and for governor and turbine is equal to 1, in which the Kt value is always fixed and Kz value can be adjusted by changing the links. Now again, as we know from the dynamics of the generator load model, Kp, the Kp is the constant, means Kp is can be written by the 1 upon B. B is what? Load damping constant. So where the B is nothing but del of PL upon del F, the unit of B is megawatt upon hertz. So by putting this B value, means Kp value, what we have to put? We have a equation. Here we have equation what? So now we will put here, we will put Kp value to 1 upon B. Now see, let's see what happened to the equation, main equation. By putting Kp is equal to 1 upon B, we will get delta F static is equal to minus of 1 upon B plus 1 upon 1 upon B. Simply I have put the value Kp is equal to 1 upon B, and we will get finally after solving this, we will get minus of 1 upon B plus 1 upon R of delta PL, and it can be also write delta PL upon beta, and beta is nothing but area frequency response characteristics. Beta is nothing but n. What we have written? We have written beta is equal to B plus 1 upon R. So B plus 1 upon R is written as a beta, and beta is what? Area frequency response characteristics. The unit of beta is per unit megawatt per hertz. So the final equation after putting the AFRC value, so delta F static is equal to minus of delta PL upon beta. So this equation can be used for numerical also. So what is the meaning of beta? Means beta is what? AFRC. So how the change in power affects the change in frequency is evaluated through AFRC. AFRC is what? It is an area frequency response characteristics. So in practice, what practical what we have get? The B value is very less than the 1 upon R. So the final value of this static frequency is nothing but delta F is equal to minus of R of delta PL. By dividing the frequency to the delta PL, what we get? We get the value of R, means the droop characteristic. So we have seen in the book also, when the power is, when the load, means delta PL is increasing, the droop characteristic means the frequency is varying according to that, means we are getting the droop characteristic from no load to full load, from no load to full load, we are getting the droop characteristics. when the load is increasing, so what I have told, the thumb rule in the starting, when the load is increasing, when the load is increasing, the frequency will decrease. So here, when the load is increasing, what we are seeing that the frequency is decreasing. This is our thumb rule. It should be always remember. Static response of load frequency control. Here we can also see the droop characteristic, in which we can see here when the load is 60%, then the droop characteristic is like that. When the load is 100%, in which that is the full load condition, then the droop characteristic is like that. So the speed regulation of governor is given by the change in frequency upon change in power output. When the, it is asked in the percentage, then we will multiply by the 100. So this is all about the uncontrolled single area load frequency control mathematical model. Now moving further to the next topic. So up to here we have covered the steady state analysis of a uncontrolled case. Now we will see the steady state analysis of a control case, in which the speed changer position is also variable and the demand is now equal to zero. So initially in the uncontrolled case, what was the case? In that case, the speed changer position was, change in speed changer position was zero and the demand was variable. Now the demand is, change the demand is zero and the speed changer position is variable. So what will happen here? So whatever the summation was here, it will equal to the zero value. So the overall block diagram of this steady state analysis of control case is like that. So we can easily see here that here is the delta PC's speed changer position. It is the governor response, which is given by the KZ upon 1 plus S into TZ, and KT for the turbine response, KT upon 1 plus S into TT, and KP upon 1 plus STP is for power system response. And delta F is just in the frequency. So 1 upon R is nothing but a regulation. So after now, the second, what we have done in case, we have to reduce this all block by using the block diagram reduction. So simply we will multiply all these value. So it, these all three blocks will be considered as a one block. So after multiplying, what we will get? We will get KZ multiplied by KT multiplied by KP upon 1 plus STZ into 1 plus STT into 1 plus STT. Similarly, again, there is a transfer function, 1 GS upon 1 plus, what is the formula of transfer function? GS upon 1 plus GS into HS. So here HS is what? 1 upon R. So after putting the value, it is our GS and GS into HS. So here our GS into HS, and it is multiplied by delta PC, and it is the change in the frequency. So initially what we have assumed in the case that KG into KT is equal to 1. So KZ and KT equal to 1, and for the step input, delta PC will equal to the delta PC upon S. So what we will put? We will put here. So we will put here KZ into KT is equal to 1. Similarly here, KZ into KT is equal to 1, and delta PC is nothing but delta PC upon S. So after putting the value 1, what we will get? We will get KP into PC upon S upon 1 plus STG, 1 plus STT, 1 plus STP plus KP upon R. So now, steady state value is obtained by applying the final value theorem. Now we are going to get the value of steady state value by applying the final value theorem. So what we will get? So it is given by the limit of S tends to 0, S into Fs. So we will put the value of Fs. We will put the value of this Fs here. So by putting the value, and what we have? We have S is equal to 0. So when we will put S is equal to 0, these all three terms here will get in, will be 0, and this L will be down by this S. So final what we have Kp into delta Pc upon 1 plus Kp into R. Okay. So now what we have done in previously, so Kp is nothing but 1 upon B. So 1 upon B, we will put Kp is equal to, we will put what? We will put Kp is equal to 1 upon B. So by putting the Kp is equal to 1 upon B, we will get 1 upon B plus 1 upon Br into delta Pc. After solving, we will get 1 upon B plus 1 upon R into delta Pc. So by dividing delta Pc, so what we will get? Delta F static upon delta Pc is equal to 1 upon 1 plus 1 upon B plus 1 upon R. This formula is again very important for numerical point of view. Now the third case is very simple case. In third case, what we will do? The third case, the delta Pc, speed changer position, and the change in load, both will be variable. So what we will do? By applying the superposition theory. So by superposition of both the cases, what we will get? We will get the third case. So no need to solve all these things. So simply the steady state change in frequency is given by the delta F static is equal to 1 upon B plus 1 upon R into delta Pc minus delta PL. So this formula is for third case. So here we will get the 3 points by looking this formula. We have an important 3 points. The first point is what? The first point is change in load demand causes change in frequency. So change in load demand. So change in load demand causes change in frequency, which is compensated by changing the position of speed changer. Changing the position of speed changer. Second important point what we have get, if the delta Pc is equal to delta PL, if delta Pc is equal to delta PL, then the change in frequency will be zero. And the third one is by reducing the R, if we will reduce the value of R, then the delta F static can be reduced. So delta F static will be reduced. Okay, so up to now we have studied the three cases. Now let me show you one more important point. After that, the single area concept will be covered. Okay. So what we have a single area load frequency control diagram. What we have solved right now, it is a single area load frequency control diagram. So we will draw practically, so we will draw the dynamic response, then we will get some error. So how to reduce the error? The question is how to reduce the error. Here, when we draw the dynamic response of frequency, then we will get the error. So how to reduce the error? So we will introduce the integral in the system. So when we will introduce the integration system or integral controller system, then the error will be reduced. So we can easily see here only we have introduced system K1 upon S. So after introducing, the error is reduces. So initially it was like that. After introducing that, the error is reduces and the time is, initially it was taking approximately 5 seconds. Now it is taking only 2 seconds approximately. So error reduces by introducing the integral controller. So I hope it is clear to all of you. Now we will see the multi-area load frequency control. Block diagram of two-area system. So as we have completed the block diagram of single-area system, now we will see here the block diagram of two-area system. So as we have done previously, it is a speed changer position, change in speed changer position, and there is a 1 upon R is regulation, and 1 upon STG is for governor system, and 1 plus STT is for turbine, and 1 plus STP means for power system response. So this KP1 is the gain constant. So PG1 is the generation in area 1, and P PD1 or PL1 is the load or demand in area 1. Similarly, in case of area 2, PC2 is change their position in area 2. Similarly, these blocks, that is the governor and turbine block for area 2, and this the power system response for area 2. Similarly, the delta PG2 power generation in area 2, and this is the PL2, that is a load or demand in area 2. They are interconnected with the tie line. The tie line power can be given by the delta change in tie line power is given by delta P tie 1. It is a function of S, that is a 1 is for area 1 and 2 is for area 2. So from where is these two term came, 1 upon S and 2 pi T12, we will see here. It is very important concept. So let me show you. Okay, so here is the area 1, that is given by A, and here is the area 2, that is given by B. So V is voltage and S is our reference. So V is voltage and S is our reference angle. Okay, so the power between A and B, the transfer power between A and B can be given by, we all know, V, magnitude of VA means voltage of A, and magnitude of V, B in voltage of V, divided by X. X is the reactance between the line A and B, and given by the sine of delta A minus delta V, the sine of difference between the reference angle of area A and area B. Since delta is a very less, so it can be assumed that D here, the PAV is equal to T of delta of SA minus delta SB. And what is T? T is nothing but tie line synchronizing coefficient. And it is given by VA, VB upon X. When we will consider delta is less than 0, then sine A, sine delta A minus delta B can be written as by cos delta A minus delta B multiplication of del of delta A minus del of delta B. So this term is given by the tie line synchronizing coefficient, that is given by T, and delta A minus delta B. As we know, the frequency is a 1 upon 2 del upon dt of delta change in reference angle. So while putting this delta F means delta D into this equation, so we will see that it is nothing but del is nothing but 2 pi del f. So when we will put this value in this equation, so PAB is nothing but T into 2 pi integration of 0 to 2 delta FA dt minus 0 to 2 delta FB into dt. A for area 1 and B for area 2. So taking the Laplace transform, what we will get? We will get 2 pi t, and we will take the Laplace transform of this integral function. We will get the value of 1 upon s. So 1 upon s del of capital F A is a function of s minus capital F B is a function of s. So when we will draw in a block, so what is P A B? P is nothing but 1 multiplication of 1 upon s into 2 pi t into the subtraction of F A minus F B. So it is given here. So F A means area for area 1. Here it is. So it is a delta F B, or we can say change in frequency for area 2, which is the difference of these two is multiplied by 2 pi T multiplied by 2 pi t. T is what? Tie line synchronizing coefficient. It is a multiplication of 1 by s, 1 by s, which is after all this block, what we will get? We will get the tie line power or PAB. So here it is written. So I hope it is clear to all of you now how the two area block diagram are drawn. Now we will see two conditions. So here we have drawn, what we have drawn? The pi line power is nothing but 2 pi T12 for area 1 and area 2. There may be a chances that there are lots of area are connected. So it may be a lots of T coefficient. But here we have to, for easiness, only 2 two area. So delta P tie line power is can be given by the multiplication of 2 pi T upon S and the difference of delta F1 minus delta F2. Now there are two conditions. The one condition is the static analysis of uncontrolled two area system, like previously we have done in single area case, and the second is the dynamic analysis of uncontrolled two area system. So it is very important, and it will be, I will recommend to write all the things in a paper so that it will be easy to remember, because lots of derivation are going on. If you will only see the this video, then it will be really very difficult to remember all these things. So once you have write all these things, you are able to easily understand by looking on the paper. Okay, so there is some exception as we have taken single area, like for an uncontrolled case, what we have to take, in which case the change in speed in that position will be constant or it will be a zero. And what will happen in uncontrolled case? Only there is a change in the load. So for control area 1, it is given by the delta P L1. For control area 2, it is given by the delta P L2. So it will be only change. Which kind of change is that? That is a step change. And what is delta P tie 1? It is a static change in tie line power transfer from area 1 to area 2. And one important consideration we have also seen in case of the single area, that delta Pg1 is equal to delta Pg2 B incremental change in generation. So this is a Pg for generation 1 for area 1 and Pg2 is generation for area 2. So we have seen that in the case of single area, what we have got? We have got delta Pg1 is static, for in case of static, steady state condition is equal to minus 1 upon R1 into multiplication of delta F is statics. So this formula is very important. The numerical can be asked from this formula. Similarly, in case of the area 2, the delta Pg2 is equal to minus of 1 upon R2 into delta F is static. R is nothing but the regulation. So net surplus power of area I, here we will write in general term, then we will convert into two area form. So the net surplus power of area I can be given by, it is universal formula, it is a function of kinetic energy and some load changes due to the frequency and incremental change in tie line power. So it is given by net surplus power means what we have generated and what we have a demand. So difference of this power is called the net surplus power. So the delta Pgi, I for the many, it may be a 3 area, 4 area or multiple area. So we have taken here area I. So delta Pgi minus delta Pli, I for demand. So the difference between two is the net surplus power, which is given by 2 Hi upon F d of dt of del Fi. This F can be written as, because everywhere I have written this one. So 2 Hi upon F d of dt of change of Fi plus Bi del of Fi plus del of P tie B. So what is B here? B is nothing but the damping constant. So what this term is called? So this term is called the stored kinetic energy due to the generator rotor. So what are the kinetic energy stored in the rotor of the generator is 2H upon F d of dt of del Fi. And what this term is called? This is called the change in load due to the change in the frequency. And delta Pti, P tie is nothing but incremental change in tie line power. Okay, so under steady state, what it is? It is assumed that under the steady state means we want to neglect the kinetic energy. So d upon dt, so d upon dt is del Fi, which is equal to zero. It is assumed that. So what we will do, this term will be the zero. So what will we have left? So delta Pgi minus delta Pli is equal to, this term is zero. So what we have left? Delta Bi delta Fi plus delta P tie I. So now substituting the value of del Pgi, what we have del Pgi? So we can see here the del Pgi is nothing but minus 1 upon R del F statics. So we will put here. So by substituting the value of what we will get for area 1, minus of 1 upon R1 delta F static minus PL1 is equal to what we are putting here, what only we are putting for area 1, we will put I is equal to 1, and for area 2, we will put I is equal to 2. So delta Pg1 is nothing but minus of delta F static upon R1. Similarly, in case of area 2, delta Pg2 is nothing but minus of delta F static upon R2. For area 1, delta PL1, and for area 2, delta PL2 is equal to, for area 1, B1 delta F1 plus delta P tie 1. And for similarly for area 2, B2 delta F2 plus delta tie P2. So here I is nothing but the static frequency, because we are dealing with the static steady state analysis or static analysis. Okay. So one important term is also here, the tie line power, change in tie line power in 2 can be given by the minus of A12 of del of pi line. Tie line power of 1. Okay. So A12 is nothing but the ratio of the rated power of area 1 divided by the area 2. So let's see here, where is A12. So we can see here in the block diagram, it is given here. Here it is given here. Tie line power. So ratio of rated power of 1 divided by the rated power of 2, change in power are rated power of 1 divided by rated power of 2 is nothing but A12. So it is given by A constant A. Okay. Now what we will get, we will only put delta P tie line of 2 is equal to minus of A12 delta P tie of 1. So we will put here, we will put here this value, this value. We will put here. So what we will get, so by putting in equation 2, we will get minus of delta F static upon R2 minus of del PL2 is equal to B2 delta F static, and minus of, now it will become minus of A12 of delta tie 1 statics. So now we have two equations having the same common term. What we want? We want to get the value of tie line power. Okay. So by looking the equation 1 and equation 4, we can see here. So by looking the equation 1, in here also the tie line power is delta P tie 1 static, and here also the tie line power. So what we will do? We will now separate it. So how we will separate? By separating, by transferring this value to right hand sides. So when we will transfer this value to right hand side, we will see here the minus of delta PL1 is equal to B1 plus 1 upon R delta F static plus del of tie line of 1 power. Yes. Now I will say tie line power 1, tie line power 2. Okay. So now the, it can be as a, in case of single area, we have know that the B, this can be written as beta 1, and beta 1 nothing but area frequency response characteristic. It is known as the area frequency response characteristic, and multiplication of delta F static plus delta P tie of power 1. Similarly, minus PL2 is equal to beta 2 frequency static minus A12 and tie line power 1. Okay. So now from equation 6 and equation 7, it can be write in a matrix form. It is a very simple form. Simply, we have write the left hand side is minus P delta, change in load is delta PL1 and minus delta PL2 for area 1 and area 2 is equal to this matrix of 1 into beta 1 and minus 1 2 into beta 2. This is a multiplication of delta P tie 1 and delta F statics. So applying the Cramer rule. So what is the Cramer rule? I think you should know the Cramer rule. What is the Cramer rule? So if we want to calculate this one, the first row term. So how we will calculate? So we will just replace this column with this value. If you want to calculate this value, this second row, so we will replace second column of by this value. So now we want to calculate the delta P tie of 1. Okay, so in that case it is the first row, so we will replace this value by delta PL and delta PL2. So delta PL upon delta L, determinant of that will be delta PL upon DL2 or beta 1 and beta 2. By cross multiplication, we will get this value. Similarly, and that divided by the determinant of this. You can easily go to the Google and you can search the Cramer rule. It is a very simple formula. So similarly, in case of the F static, it is a second row. So in that case, we will replace this value by this, because we want to replace second column. So in that case, minus delta PL1 and delta PL2, in cross multiplication of this determinant, we will find this value, that is the minus delta PL2 minus delta PLA2 divided by the determinant of this, determinant of this value. So it is nothing but beta 2 plus A12 upon beta 1. So now up to here, we have calculated the tie line power of 1 and the static frequency in terms of change in load and change in beta. Beta is nothing but AFRC, that is area frequency response characteristics. Okay. Now we will assume for easiness, suppose it is given that the area 1 and area 2 are identical. So what are the assumptions in that case when the area 1 and area 2 will be identical? So in that case, if beta 1 or equal to beta 2, we will take it is equal to beta, and R1 is equal to R2, we will take only R. B1 only we will now convert it to 1 and 2 to a simpler form. So beta 1, beta 2 is beta, R1, R2 is R, B1, B2 is B. So tie line power can be given as beta of what we have initially. Okay. So tie line power was initially here beta 2 delta PL1 plus beta 1 delta PL2. So we will put only beta, so minus beta PL1 plus beta del PL2 upon beta plus A12 beta. So similarly, we will write here, so beta will be common and it will be only left delta PL2 minus delta PL1 divided by beta will be again common and 1 plus A12. So beta will cancel out. And suppose we will assume the area 1 and area 2 is identical, and if the rated power of area 1 and area 2 will be same, so in that case A12 will be the PR1 upon PR2, the rated power will be same, then the it will be equal to 1. So what we will get, the tie line power, change in tie line power is equal to change in load of area 2 minus change in load of area 1 divided by 2. So now if load change occur only in area 2, suppose there is only change in area 2, because there is area 1 and area 2, suppose load is changing in only in area 2, so what will happen? So in that case, change in area 1, change in power in area 1 will be 0, so we will put here 0. So what we will get, so the tie line power we will get is equal to delta PL upon 2. If the load changes occur only in area 2, so delta PL is equal to 0 and the tie line power is equal to delta PL upon 2 in per unit. So what is mean by that PL2 upon 2? The mean of this is half of added load in area 2. So half of added load in area 2 is supplied by area 1 through tie line. Similarly, in case of the static frequency change, that is given by the minus of del PL2 minus del PL1 upon 2 beta. So del PN 0, because the load changes only in area 2. So in that case, the minus of delta PL2 upon 2 beta. So what is meaning by that? The meaning of that is the steady state frequency reduces to 50%. Not reduces to, means reduces by 50%. The daily change in the frequency is the 50%. So up to now, here we have studied the steady state response of two area system. Now we will see the dynamic response of two area system. So here again, some assumption are involved. So what we will assume? We will assume the two identical control area, that area 1 and area 2 are identical. And in that case, the TZ1 and TT is equal to 0. And the dynamic constant B of the two area is neglected. That means the B1 is equal to B2 is equal to 0. So net surplus power is given by, as we all know, the delta PZI minus delta PLI is equal to 2HI upon F into delta D upon DT of delta FI and BI, something like that. Okay. So when in case of area 1 and area 2, we will replace I is equal to 1 and 2. So what we will get, we will first, we will, as we have assumed the damping constant in 0. So this term will be a 0 and the remaining term will be, for area 1 is equal to delta PZ1 minus delta PL1 is equal to 2 times of H1 upon S D upon DT of del F1 plus del of tie 1. This is for area 1. Similarly, in case of the area 2, we can write. Now, taking the Laplace transform, what we will get? By taking the Laplace transform, we will get the delta PZ1 is equal to delta PZ is function of S. Similarly, delta PL function of S is equal to 2H. This term, D of DT, can be written by the S of del of FS plus delta P tie S. Similarly, in case of area 2, we can write. Okay. Now, rearranging the term, we want to know the value of delta F1 and delta F2 so that we can put the value somewhere. So, delta F1 is equal to F upon, by just transferring this value, P tie line value is left hand side. So, delta PZ1 minus delta PL2 minus delta P tie 1 divided by F will be in denominator and 2H. 1s will be in denominator. Similarly, case of area 2. So we have an equation of 5 and 6 in the terms of frequency, change in frequency for area 1 and change in frequency for area 2. So what we have assumed here? So we, in the area 2, we have assumed that the R1 and R2 will be given as R and the time constant will be 0, or governor time constant and turbine time constant will be 0. These all will be 0 and it is an uncontrolled case. So, delta PC1 is also 0. So, by looking at the diagram, we can easily say the PZ1, it will equal to only 1 and this is having a 0. So, PZ1 nothing but the delta F multiplied by 1 upon R1 and here is a negative value. So, delta 1 multiplied by R1 and it is a negative value because it is a negative feedback. Okay, this is a negative feedback. So, delta PZ1 is equal to minus of delta F1 upon R. As I told you, it is a very important formula. Similarly, in case of the power generation is equal to change in frequency upon regulation. Again, okay. So tie line power can be seen here. The tie line power is nothing but 2 pi T12 upon S into the difference between the change in frequency in area 1 and change in frequency in area 2. So, similarly, in case of tie line power of area 2 is can be given by the minus of delta of P tie line power of 1. How it can we can get here? Because it is because we are assuming that the rated power of area 1 and area 2 will be shown. In that case, A12 will be 1. So what we have, the change in tie line power is equal to A12 of minus of change in tie line power of area 1. So we will put A12 is equal to 1 and also we will assume H1 is equal to H2 is equal to H. Okay. So, by putting the value in 5 and 6, what we will get? What is the equation of 5 and 6? There we will put these values. Okay. So, here this is the value of 5 and 6. Here we have, we can see here this is the value of 5 and this is the value of 6, equation 6. What we will get? We will get this value. We have just putting the value in equation 5. So what we have get? So we have get the minus, we have put the value of PZ1 and we have put also the value of PZ2 and here the tie line power in case of, then after rearranging the term, we will get the delta F1S. This value is transferred to left hand side, so it will be given as 1 plus F upon 2 HRS is equal to minus of F upon 2 HS is nothing but delta PL1S plus delta P tie of S. So, what we have done, we have just transferred this value to left hand side. Similarly, in case of area 2, we have transferred by putting the value in equation 6, we have transferred this value. Now these value F1 and F2, where it will go? It will go to this formula, as we have seen from this diagram. So we have seen from this diagram. So by putting the value of F1 and F2, what will happen? We will see here. Why we are doing this? Because we want to get the frequency. At what frequency? The change in frequency when there is a change in load. So that is why we are doing all these things. Okay. So by putting the value in this formula, that is a p tie line is equal to 2 pi t. By putting the value of delta F1 and by putting the value of delta F2, we will get simply this. Okay. Write parallelly so that you will be not confused. Okay, by putting the value of this and this, what we will get by rearranging the terms. So 2 pi t1 2 upon s, and this one will be a common, minus 1 upon 2 hs and minus f2 upon 2 hs. It is a common term, and the denominator is also common. So we will just take it the common, and the whole value will come is delta p l1 s plus delta p tie line of s minus of this minus of s is equal to delta p l2 s minus of delta p tie line of s. So by rearranging, so this 2 hs will be cut. And okay, by arranging these all things, we will get the this value is same. Now what we have done? We have done the PL1 minus PL2 plus P tie line of 1 minus P tie line 2. Okay. So by and here again looking for the numerator and denominator, what we will get? We will get the 2 is cancelled out by 2 and R is cancelled out by R. And here the tie line of change in power can be written as minus of delta of tie line of power 1, because A is 1, because we have assumed that the rated power of area 1 is equal to rated power of area 2. Okay. So what we have left? Pi T1 to F divided by SS multiplication S square into H, and what we have left in bracket? 1 plus F upon 2H RS, and in the big bracket what we have? We have a delta PL2 minus delta PL1 s minus of this value minus minus is equal to 2 of del of P tie of s. So change in tie line power is a terms of here. So we will also transfer this into the left hand side so that it can be separated. So after transferring this value, the change in tie line power in 1 is nothing but 1 plus 2 pi T1 2 upon S square H 1 plus F upon 2 H RS is equal to pi T1 2 upon S upon S square H and 2 H RS. Simply we can see here that it is nothing but just it will be multiplication of this, and it will go to the left hand side and the sign become the plus, and here the same term is left, pi t1 2 f upon s square h into 1 plus f upon 2 hs. So again by multiplying this term to here cross multiplication, so this value is come upon s square h 1 plus f upon 2 h rs plus 2 pi t1 2 f divided by this value s square h 1 plus f upon 2 h rs is equal to pi t1 2 f upon s square h 1 plus f and delta pl1 s is minus delta p sorry delta pl2 s minus delta pl1 s. So this denominator is cancelled out by this denominator, and after rearranging the term we will get the h is cancelled out by h and this s is cancelled out by this s. Okay, after transferring this value to here in denominator, what we will get? The tie line power of s is equal to pi of t1 to f upon del of change in pl2 minus del of pl1 s divided by s square s plus sf upon 2r plus 2 pi t1 to f. So again by taking the common h, what we will get? We will get the s square plus f upon 2r h s plus 2 pi t1 to h to f. So this is the term, and in this bracket what we have, delta PL2 minus delta PL1 upon S square plus something into S plus omega square. So this is the terms of what is of a damping frequency. So how we will calculate the damping frequency? Look here, if alpha is equal to positive and omega square is equal to positive, the system is stable and it will damp. Okay, the system will operate at a damp angular frequency when the load changes in the area is given by, so it is given by omega naught is equal to under root of omega square minus alpha square. How we will get? So S square 2As plus omega square can be written as S plus alpha square plus omega square minus alpha square, and this can be written as omega naught square. It is a damp angular frequency. So damp angular frequency is nothing but under root of omega square minus alpha square. By comparing this term, the omega is nothing but 2 pi T1 to F upon H, and the alpha is nothing but F upon 4 HR, because it is a 2 here, so we will divide by 2, so it is a F upon 2 HR square. So there are some important point camp which can be asked in the exam, and this derivation can be asked in the subjective exam. So only 3 point we can see here. The frequency, the angular frequency is terms of R, H and F. It is depend upon this value. So F and R are constant, so angular frequency depend upon only the value of R. Okay, so when the lower value of R gives a stronger damping, so it is a, it will give a stronger damping. So one important point is here, it will give this stronger damping. Second, when higher value of R, when the R will be high, then in that case it will lead to the poor damping. And one objective question is asked in the GATE examination, when R is infinity, so what will happen? The system will have undamped oscillation. So here, up to now, we have covered all the topics of single area and multi area, static and dynamic response. So I hope it is clear to all of you. If there is any doubt, you can ask me question or you can mail me. Okay. Thank you very much.